Good day, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you for standing by, and welcome to Alibaba Group's March quarter and full fiscal year 2020 results conference call. At this time, all participants are in a listen-only mode. After management's prepared remarks, there will be a question and answer session. I'd now like to hand the call over to Rob Lin, Head of Investor Relations of Alibaba Group.
Rob, can you hear me?
Please go ahead.
听得到，我们听到你，你听到我们吗？外面的声音还没进来是吧？还没有，外面还没有。
OK，没关系。
Operator, can you hear me?
Please go ahead.
Operator? Okay. Good day, everyone, and welcome to Alibaba Group's March quarter 2020 and fiscal year 2020 results conference call. With us are Lin Zhang, Executive Chairman and CEO, Joe Tsai, Executive Vice Chairman, Maggie Wu, Chief Financial Officer. This call is also being webcast from our IR section of the corporate website. A replay of the call will be available on our website later today. Now, let me quickly cover the safe harbor. Today's discussion will contain forward-looking statements, including revenue guidance. These forward-looking statements involve inherent risks and uncertainties that may cause actual results to differ materially from our current expectations, including risk and uncertainty related to the COVID-19 pandemic. For detailed discussions of these risks and uncertainties, please refer to our latest annual report on Form 20-F and other documents filed with the U.S. SEC, nor announced on the website of the Hong Kong Stock Exchange. Any forward-looking statements that we make on this call are both based on assumptions as of today, and we do not undertake any obligation to update these statements except as required under applicable law. Please note that certain financial measures that we use on this call, such as adjusted EBITDA, adjusted EBITDA margin, adjusted EBITA, adjusted EBITA margin, marketplace-based core commerce adjusted EBITA, non-GAAP net income, non-GAAP diluted earnings per share or ADS, and cash flow are expressed on a non-GAAP basis. Our GAAP results and reconciliations of GAAP to non-GAAP measures can be found in our earnings press release. Unless otherwise stated, growth rate of all stated metrics mentioned during this call refers to year-on-year growth versus the same quarter last year. In addition, during today's call, management will give their prepared remarks in English. A third-party translator will provide simultaneous Chinese translation on another conference line. Please refer to our press release for details. During the Q&A session, we will take questions in both English and Chinese, and the third-party translator will provide consecutive translation. All translations are of convenience purpose only. In the case of any discrepancies, management statement in the original language will prevail. With that, I will now turn the call to Daniel.
Thank you, Rob. Hello, everyone. Thank you for joining our earnings call today. We have finished an extraordinary quarter and delivered an outstanding fiscal year. Despite the impact of COVID-19 pandemic, Alibaba achieved the historical milestone of $1 trillion in GMV across our digital economy this fiscal year, a strategic goal that we set for ourselves 5 years ago. We at Alibaba have always been aiming for the stars while keeping our feet on the ground. The $1 trillion GMV milestone reflects the vitality of Alibaba's digital economy and as well as strong execution against the clear strategic vision. Our scale has now reached 1/6 of China's total retail sales, which was about $6 trillion last year, and we believe there is still tremendous potential of growth. Digital adoption and transformation in retail are accelerating due to the COVID-19 pandemic, reshaping consumer behavior and enterprise operations. On the consumer side, shopping online has become a habit for more people and in more product categories. On the retail side, online sales is no longer an option, but a necessity for the brick and mortars. We believe there is a new normal that will stay even after the pandemic is over. I would like to review the past quarter's performance in the context of the impact and recovery from the COVID-19 pandemic. On January 23rd, right before the Chinese New Year holiday, China announced the lockdown of Wuhan, the center of the pandemic. The lockdown measures implemented in other provinces and cities led to large-scale economic disruption in late January and February, which negatively affected our domestic e-commerce business during the period. However, China quickly contained the pandemic by implementing measures such as strict social distancing, vast testing coverage, centralized mobilization of medical resources, and started to reopen the country for business in late February. By March 9, Cainiao announced full recovery of logistic operation nationwide, except for Hubei province, where Wuhan is, and a normal life began to return for most of people in the country when Wuhan 10-week lockdown was lifted on April 8. Since March, we have seen a healthy recovery in our China retail marketplaces. As of March 31, 2020, active consumers on our China retail marketplaces reached 726 million, a net increase of 15 million versus the previous quarter. Mobile MAUs of our China retail marketplaces reached 846 million in March 2020, an increase of 22 million over December 2019. This reflects Taobao's strong consumer mindshare and healthy user stickiness. Since the new fiscal year began in April, the quarter-to-date paid GMV of our China retail marketplaces has experienced year-on-year growth at a similar rate to the December quarter's level. For the past several years, we have been investing to grow our new retail business in fresh food and grocery. Free Shippo and Taoxianda, which have played an important role in supplying daily necessities to people impacted during the pandemic, and have become widely popular among consumers. In the past quarter, both Free Shippo and Taoxianda deliver stellar growth of more than 100% year-on-year. Approximately 60% of Free Shippo's GMV came from online orders, up by 10 percentage points year-over-year. As lockdown measures eased in China starting in April, demand and the popularity of our grocery business have remained strong. We believe the consumer habit of buying fresh food and groceries online will continue after the pandemic, and online and offline integration will drive the new retail model to the next stage of development. We have been investing for years to build the new retail technology infrastructure, which will help us further strengthen our market leadership in this sector. As the leading cross-border import platform in China, Tmall Global has become an ever more important destination for Chinese consumers to buy imported products as they could not travel abroad during the pandemic. In markets outside of China, our international retail marketplaces, such as Lazada and AliExpress, attracted over 180 million annual active consumers as of March 2020. Lazada's order volume grew more than 100% year-on-year during the fiscal year and completed the March quarter with a strong finish despite the impact of the COVID-19 pandemic. During February and March 2020, our cross-border marketplace AliExpress GMV growth was negatively impacted mainly by supply chain and logistics disruptions caused by COVID-19 pandemic. We are seeing signs of recovery in certain major markets starting in April, but there are still uncertainties ahead. Revenue from our local consumer services business decreased by 8% year-on-year in the past quarter due to the impact of COVID-19. In April, year-on-year growth of our food delivery GMV turned positive as lockdown measures eased. Restaurants began reopening and people began returning to work in China. Alibaba Cloud continued its rapid growth in the past fiscal year, with revenue reaching 40 billion RMB, an increase of 62% year-on-year. During pandemic, our public cloud business grew rapidly, driven by increased consumption of video content as well as wide adoption of remote working and learning. Our cloud computing infrastructure and big data business have also played a key role in enabling business to quickly resume operation and production. We believe the pandemic will further accelerate digital transformation of enterprises. All industries, including public sectors, will choose to move their technology infrastructure to the cloud. DingTalk, our digital collaboration platform for enterprises, played a key role during the pandemic. Millions more enterprises and users in China are now using DingTalk to stay connected and work remotely. DingTalk also made significant penetration in the education sector as schools adopt the platform for their teachers and students. In March 2020, DingTalk conducted an average of over 1 million active classroom sessions on each school day. DingTalk's number of daily average active consumers during working day grew significantly to 155 million in March. As offices and schools reopen in China, DingTalk's number of active users came down from the peak level, but still maintained at more than 100 million DAU. In the past quarter, our digital media and entertainment business delivered healthy growth in paying subscribers and user time spent. As users' consumption of video content increased significantly during the pandemic, Youku will continue its focus on production and distribution of original and exclusive content while ensuring cost efficiencies and return on investment. During the past quarter, we leveraged our platform technology and other resources across the Alibaba ecosystem to support populations impacted by COVID-19 pandemic within China and around the world. We also implemented a comprehensive set of financial and business support measures to help alleviate the near-term challenge faced by our business customers and partners. As of March 31st, 2020, Alibaba, together with Ant Financial, have contributed approximately 3.4 billion RMB in value in the form of donations, subsidies, and tech support. To name a few examples, we waived fees, reduced commissions, and offered logistics subsidies to our merchants. We work with Ant Financial and other partners to advance working capital funds to our merchants to provide liquidity and to facilitate one-year loans with preferential interest rates. We use the 1 billion RMB special fund we established in January to procure medical and related supplies for parts of China affected by pandemic. Our logistics subsidiary, Cainiao, offered free delivery of medical supplies to destinations around the world through its extensive global logistics network. Our self-operated fresh food and grocery chain Freshippo committed to more than 200 remaining open for business, even during a period when lockdown measures were in effect. Freshippo also worked with its supply chain to keep our commitment to not raising prices as well as maintaining adequate stock on the shelves. We made available AI technology to over 550 hospitals in China to help improving the speed and efficiency of their COVID-19 diagnosis during CT lung scans. The Alibaba Foundation, through combined efforts with Jack Ma Foundation and the Joe and Clara Tsai Foundation, donated over 200 million units of personal protective equipment, testing kits, and ventilators to over 150 countries and regions. In April 2020, we further announced the 2020 Spring Thunder initiative, which aims to help export-oriented SMEs explore opportunities in the China domestic market through our China retail marketplaces and expand into new markets through our international wholesale and retail marketplaces such as Alibaba.com and AliExpress to develop digitalized manufacturing clusters to accelerate the digital transformation of China's agricultural sector and alleviate financing challenges faced by SMEs by working with Ant Financial and its partners. The battle against the COVID-19 pandemic is not over. Although China has made good progress in fighting and controlling the spread of the coronavirus, with most businesses reopening and the people returning to normal life, the threat of the pandemic is still looming in the rest of the world, and the timing and the pace of recovery is still uncertain. At the same time, tensions between the U.S. and China have added another layer of uncertainty to the post-COVID-19 world. Despite the uncertainties in the macroeconomic and the geopolitical environment, there is one thing we can certain. The world is moving towards digital first and the digital everything. In the past two decades, Alibaba has developed comprehensive infrastructure and the capabilities built on digital technology for business, financial services, logistics, cloud computing, and big data to prepare for this new era. We believe our infrastructure and capabilities will play an important role in enabling all industries to embrace digital transformation and customers to embrace a digital lifestyle. In addition, we aim to empower SMEs around the world, including those in America, to access the Chinese and other global consumer markets and create new jobs. This is a hack that Alibaba must undertake to fulfill our mission to make it easy to do business anywhere. And it is also the fundamental assurance for our sustainable growth in the future. Now, I will turn it over to Maggie, who will walk you through the details of our financial results.
Thank you, Mike. Thank you, everyone, for joining us. I'd like to start my prepared remark by addressing COVID-19's impact on our financials and recent trends. Back in February, given the potential uncertainties of COVID-19 pandemic, we guided the market that our overall revenue growth rate would be negatively impacted for the March quarter, and that some of the businesses, such as China retail marketplaces and local consumer services, might show negative revenue growth. I'm pleased to report we delivered better than expected March quarter results. The government took effective measures to limit the spread of the virus through lockdown, social distancing measures, and travel restrictions. With the virus spread under control in China, these restrictions started to ease in early March, and this led to a recovery of supply chain and logistic delivery capacity. This in turn enabled a quick recovery for our China retail marketplaces and improving fundamentals for local consumer service businesses. For our China retail marketplaces, Tmall online physical goods GMV, this is a paid GMV, grew 10% in the March quarter. Although only 10% growth, we did see robust demand of FMCG and consumer electronics categories as homebound consumers cooked at home and upgraded home appliances and 3C products. These two categories combined grew 25% on our Tmall platform. On the other hand, discretionary product categories such as apparel and accessories, home furnishing, and auto parts experienced negative growth. Starting in April, Tmall online physical goods GMV saw strong growth, a strong recovery, and has continued to further improve in May. Local consumer services recorded 8% decline in revenue this quarter, reflecting mass closures of restaurants and local merchants. However, social distancing measures also led to increased demand for groceries and other daily necessities. Starting in April, GMV growth of food delivery businesses, Ele.me, turned positive as lockdown measures eased. Restaurants began reopening and people began returning to work in China. For our international commerce business, which represents around 7% of total revenue in fiscal 2020, the timing and pace of a recovery is still uncertain, as demand in countries outside China may be further impacted by COVID-19. So let's take a look at the March quarter financial highlights. Our total revenue was 114 billion RMB, grew by 22% year over year. The increase was mainly driven by growth of China commerce retail business, especially new retail businesses in grocery category and cloud computing. We continue to be successful at expanding product offerings on our platform that cater to the needs of different consumer segments. The decrease of non-GAAP free cash flow was due to a one-off of AliExpress payment service restructuring. So this we had a full disclosure in our earnings release. This is mainly due to the overseas regulation requirement change, and that AliExpress began the process of a restructure so that it no longer holds the consumer funds before they release to the merchants. That if we take that impact out, our non-GAAP free cash flow would have been over 2 billion RMB. Let's take a look at the revenue in details. China commerce retail grew 21%. Customer management revenue grew 3%. The growth of customer management revenue was primarily due to the increase in revenue from recommendation fees and Taobao Live, these new revenue streams, partially offset by a decrease in volume of paid clicks and average unit price per click. These are the you know, the pay click and the PPC I'm talking about is for the search business, P4P. So this is impacted because this COVID-19. Commission revenue decreased 2%, primarily due to effects of the COVID-19 impact. These impacts including cancellation of some orders as a result of logistic disruption in February, weakness in apparel categories, our waiver of annual service fees for the first half of 2020 as part of our support to merchant customers. International retail revenue grew 8% to 5.4 billion RMB. The increase is primarily due to the growth of Lazada and Trendyol, and partially offset by the exclusion of revenue from AliExpress Russia, which was no longer consolidated since October 2019. So we had a JV in Russia right now. Cainiao revenue reached 5 billion RMB, growing at 28% year on year. This was primarily due to the increase in the volume of orders fulfilled from our fast-growing cross-border and international commerce retail businesses. And our local consumer service experienced a negative growth this quarter I just talked about. So for Ali Cloud, it's still growing strongly at 58%. And let's take a look at the March quarter cost trend. Cost of revenue, excluding SBC, was 62% of revenue. The increase was primarily due to a revenue mix shift towards direct sales businesses, the new retail businesses, such as our new retail, and also consolidation of Kaola, and partially offset by decreasing delivery costs of our local consumer services. Let's turn to segment profitabilities. Our market-based core commerce adjusted EBITDA reached 34 billion, decreased 2%. But core commerce adjusted EBITDA grew 2% to 28 billion. This is because losses in our four strategic commerce initiatives were narrowed compared to prior year, driven by ongoing improvement of China logistics network, higher demand for FreshCo, and the lower variable costs required for our local consumer service business. I would like to mention about the innovation initiatives. When you look at their adjusted EBITDA loss was 3.1 billion RMB, which is up from 1.9 billion from a year ago. The increase is primarily due to our aggressive investment in DingTalk to provide remote work collaboration capabilities to enterprises and schools free of charge during the COVID-19. As a result, daily active user on DingTalk achieved a fourfold increase to over 100 million. The peak DAU is about 155 million. So March quarter other financial metrics, the share of results of equity investee in the quarter reached 3.5 billion. The year-over-year increase in share of results of equity investee was mainly due to our share of profits in Ant Financial in December quarter, as we take its profit in one quarter lag, partially offset by decrease in our share of results of Suning. March quarter gap to non-gap net income. The gap net income attributed to shareholder was 3.2 billion. The year-over-year decrease was primarily due to net loss in investment income, mainly reflecting decreases in the market prices of our equity investments in publicly traded companies compared to net gain recorded in the same quarter of 2019. Non-GAAP net income attributable to shareholders increased by 12% to 25 billion RMB. Now let's look at the fiscal 2020 full year results. GMV, as Daniel mentioned, the Alibaba digital economy achieved an important milestone of $1 trillion U.S. dollar GMV target. You probably remember that this is the target we committed to do 5-6 years ago. User growth. Annual active consumers in China reached 780 million, including 726 million are China retail marketplaces. In other words, one out of every two Chinese are buying our platform. 780 million of annual active consumer in China accounts for around 85% and 40% of the Chinese population in developed and the less developed areas. Our ability to attract users at a rapid pace reflects not only the diversity of product selection, but also the platform has become an everyday destination for entertainment and discovery of new trends. We continue to achieve strong revenue growth across all businesses, including core commerce, cloud computing, and other business. So total revenue grew 35% to 510 billion RMB. Talk about the profitability. In the last 12 months, we grew adjusted EBITDA by 28% to 137 billion RMB and generated 131 billion RMB in non-GAAP free cash flow. This is significant firepower for our long-term growth. Okay, let's turn to our business segments. All of the revenue we talked about for each sector shows strong growth. And then when you look at the their adjusted EBITDA, profit for the core are still growing strongly, and the investment areas that these businesses who are in the investment stage are progressing very well, and loss gets narrowed. Okay, so I would like to talk about our outlook, but before that, I want to address the recent bill passed by the U.S. Senate called the Holding Foreign Companies Accountable Act. The proposed legislation would essentially prohibit a foreign issuer from being listed on a U.S. stock exchange if the U.S. Public Company Accounting Oversight Board, this is applicable, is unable to inspect the audit work papers of the issuer's auditors for three consecutive years due to certain reasons. We're closely monitor the development of this bill, and I think it's important for investors to understand Alibaba's practice and issues raised under this proposed legislation. First, there is an existing framework of the peekaboo conduct of the peekaboo and for its conduct and inspection of audits on companies with Chinese operations. In this regard, we understand that there has been ongoing dialogue among the Big Four accounting firms, Chinese securities regulator, CSRC, SEC, and peekaboo with respect to the types of information that are permitted to be exchanged on issuers with Chinese operations while maintaining compliance with Chinese laws. Number two, Alibaba's financial statements are prepared in accordance with U.S. GAAP. And since our inception in 1999, we have been audited by PwC Hong Kong. PwC Hong Kong is the local affiliate of the worldwide PwC firm, and its auditing standards are overseen by the PwC National Office in the United States. The integrity of Alibaba's financial statements speaks for itself. We have been an SEC filer since 2014 and hold ourselves to the high standard of transparency. Each year, we have received unqualified audit opinion on our financial statements from PwC. Third, trust is one of our core values, and transparency and integrity are essential components of building trust with all of our stakeholders. All these years, we have consistently aimed to grow the business for long term, maintain compliance with all applicable laws and delivered value for our customers, employees, and investors. Investors who bought our stock in 2014 IPO have tripled their investment over the past 5.5 years. Given the above, we will endeavor to comply with any legislation whose aim is to protect and bring transparency to investors who buy securities on U.S. stock exchanges. Looking ahead, despite a challenging quarter due to pandemic, we achieved our guidance of over 500 billion in revenue and delivered healthy, sustainable profit growth in fiscal year 2020. The reason we have been able to deliver these results is that we sowed seeds years ago by investing in technology in innovation and in businesses that required foresight and long-term patience. Today, the Alibaba digital economy remains strong and growing. Looking ahead, we will continue the same strategy of delivering robust revenue growth and sustainable profit growth. Although it is difficult to predict the uncertainty of global economic and geopolitical developments, based on our current view of Chinese domestic consumption and enterprise digitization, we expect to generate over 650 billion RMB in total revenue in fiscal year 2021. We believe a commitment to invest and deepen our value proposition to customers, thereby ensuring robust revenue and profit growth. That concludes our prepared remarks. Let's open for Q&A. Thank you.
Thank you, Maggie. Hi, everyone. So for today's call, you are welcome to ask questions in Chinese or English. Third-party translator will provide consecutive interpretation for the Q&A session. And our management will address your questions in the language you asked. Please note that the translation is for convenience purpose only. In the case of any discrepancies, our management statement in the original language. So, operator, I'd like to open up for questions.
Thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, we will now begin the question and answer session.
Operator?
If you wish to ask a question, please press star 1 on your telephone and wait for your name to be announced. Once again, to give more people the opportunity to ask questions, please keep yourself to no more than one question at a time. Once again, if you wish to ask a question, please press star 1 on your telephone. Your first
operator.
Question comes from the line of Binnie Wong from HSBC. Please ask your question.
Hey, Daniel, Maggie, Rob, 谢谢接受我的提问。想请教一下，就是我们这个就是在低端城市的 strategy， 就是想，因为我们看到就是淘宝最近就上个礼拜呀、也发报了，就是说我们有升级的版本，然后呢里面有一些就比如说有一些新的就是你们的一些策略啊，然后就是比如说一些对商家的一些支持、一些扶持，然后就是有带货达人啊这些就是低端的一个 penetration， 然后我也看到呢，就是这个 patch release 呢。我们的那个new customer from lower tier 还是继续很强劲，到70%多。那想请教一下管理层，就是新的一年我们在低端的一些策略谢谢。
Thank you, Daniel, Maggie, and Rob. My question is regarding your strategy in lower tier cities. I note that last week you issued a new release, a new patch release for Taobao, providing new support for merchants. as well as other new features, and 70% of the uptake for that new patch release has in fact been from the lower tier cities. So can you please speak to us about your strategy going forward for the lower tier cities?
好的，我回答一下这个问题啊，就是今天以淘宝的这个体量，我们中国的零售平台，其实我们这个7亿这个2000多万的这个 AAC 用户当中，其实覆盖了。 这个应该说是最广泛的人群，从最高端到最低端都有，去年我们整个的中国零售市场的增长的这个7000多万的用户当中，有 70% 是来自于低端的市场。
Thank you, and I will take that question. Given the size and the scale of Taobao as a retail platform and where it's at today, 700 million, the fact is that we've penetrated all segments of the market from the high end down to the low, and the increase in the user base over the past year, 70 million, 70% of that came from the lower tier cities.
对，所以现在我们对于这些这个来自于低端城市的用户，我们其实给他提供多样化的服务，包括我们现在在淘宝的主客户端上，有我们的这个很多的 value for money 的这些供给，同时我们也有很多直播。 很多的多样化的一些用户互动的平台，来服务这些低端城市的用户，特别是性价比的用户。同时，我们大家也已经看到了，我们也推出了新的淘宝特价版，能够针对这些低端城市的用户，能够为他们提供一个更简洁的一个完全性价比的平台。所以我们是一个综合的立体的一个策略。
Thank you. So what we're doing in the lower tier cities is deploying a more diverse and broad range of different services, including on Taobao with more value for money offerings, as well as live streaming and other kinds of engagement that are targeted for those users, especially those who are looking for good value for money. And as you've noted, we have a new special price edition of Taobao, which is targeted for those users in lower tier cities with a focus on giving them value for money offerings.
同时我们也看到在这个低端市场上我们还有进一步的这个用户增长的潜力，因为现在我们看中国市场的 AAC, 7.8亿的 AAC 当中，这个来自于这个低端城市和甚至农村的，现在是这个 覆盖了45%的这样地区的人群，但是我们看到还有 很多的人群我们还可以进一步覆盖，所以我们跟支付宝一起，会进一步的再通过这个把他们首先数字化，来进一步把他们变成消费者，这是我们的一个阿里巴巴数字经济体的一个一体化的策略。
At the same time, we see significant potential for further growing our user base. The current figure for annual active consumers, 780 million, represents only 45% penetration of the population in lower tier cities and in the rural areas of China. So there still is lots of room to grow in those regions, and we intend to do so together with Alipay in driving a digitalization strategy in those areas that will convert people into consumers. Thank you.
Thank you. Our next question comes from the line of Eddie Leung from Bank of America. Please go ahead.
Hey, 管理团队，你们好，谢谢。有一个问题是关于怎么看这个带货直播对行业的一些长期的影响。 如果我们看见一些商家都需要给一些费用，中间的一些 KOL 或是一些名人，这个会不会影响所有的一些 e-commerce 的一些平台一个盈利率呢？谢谢。
Thank you. My question is regarding the long-term impact of live streaming on the industry, and in particular, celebrity host and KOL live streaming. The question is, if merchants need to pay these celebrities, these KOLs, will that impact on the profitability of platforms going forward?
谢谢 Eddie, 这个是个很好的问题。其实现在我们看到 这个带这个直播带货已经成为一种重要的一种新的销售方式啊。现在这个这个越来越多的这个达人，包括一些名人，现在也开始进入到这个领域。那么这个本质上从零售啊这个来看，它本质上是一种销售方式啊。这个无论是达人还是名人，最终是扮演一个这个销售员、推广员的一个角色啊，他赚一个销售佣金。
Thank you, and that's a really good question. What we're seeing really is the emergence of live streaming as a new kind of sales methodology or a new kind of sales channel. With the emergence of these KOLs and celebrity influencers online, the role that they're really playing in the context of retail is sales. They're serving as salespeople, and they make money by way of a sales commission.
所以从长期来看，这个我们认为这样的方式最终还是要看整个的这个商业价值啊，是不是能够得到一个有效的实现啊？因为这个一次性的这样的一个这个销售，大批量的销售啊，带来的这样的一个用户啊，在未来是不是能够被这个持续的经营啊，而不是只是一次性的销售？不然的话，从商家的角度啊，付出一个大额的推广成本给一个达人或者红人啊，这个他之所以愿意付这个成本，一方面是一个过去的渠道成本和推广成本的代替啊，但是更重要的是说，他能够把这样的一些用户啊，能够沉淀下来，进行一个长期的啊用户生命周期内的一个运营。这个恰恰是阿里巴巴我们做这个直播、做这个带货啊，包括跟这些达人红人合作的一个非常重要的优势和基础啊，因为我们是一个综合性的这个 marketplace 啊，有多样化的用户 engagement。和用户这个互动的这个场景和销售方式啊，我们不把直播带货看成一个独立的业务形态和销售形态，我们把它看成整体的消费者运营啊的一部分啊，最终是帮助商家获得这个长期的这个价值的实现。
In the long term, how this trend will play out, I think really comes down to whether the intrinsic commercial value in terms of having online influencers and KOLs do live streaming be fully captured in an efficient and effective way. If you have a one-off sales event with a celebrity influencer, you get a user to make a one-off purchase, fine, but the question is, can you then keep that user in the long term and continue to market to them and get the full value out of that relationship? So, you know, I think it's important if you're paying money to these online influencers or celebrities that you're convert, in part, that's about supplanting existing channel costs and saving costs there. But more importantly, it's about getting the new consumer into your ecosystem so that they can become a long-term consumer. And this is critical to Alibaba because we are a diversified ecosystem with multiple channels and formats for engaging consumers. So that's precisely what we're looking at doing with these kinds of live streaming approaches. It's just one part of an overall integrated approach through which we hope to develop those long-term relationships and create long-term value.
Next question.
Thank you. Next question comes from the line of Yu Mubai from Goldman Sachs. Please go ahead.
Thank you for taking my question. I have one question with regards to the guidance you provided for next year. What are the drivers of that growth assumption or guidance you provided? And in particular, what are the underlying macro assumptions you've made? And more generally, the platform mix that you're likely, the 1P versus 3P mix that you're likely to see that's underpinning that guidance. Thank you. I'll go back to the queue afterwards.
好，谢谢。我的问题呢是，我的问题是关于你们刚才提到的，对于明年的指引，我想知道这样的指引背后，你们认为有哪些驱动因素？然后更加重要的是，它背后你们是做了什么样的一些宏观面、宏观经济方面的一些假设，有哪怎样的一些假设？那么另外对于平台的这个组合，就是1P、3P 的一个组合比例，你们做了什么样的假设或打算？
Okay, Piyush, this is Maggie. Let me try to answer your question. So we all know that we're facing risks and uncertainties, right? So many of which we're not able to predict or control. So whether there's going to be a second wave or when will that vaccine come, how much impact would the geopolitical issue bring, we, you know, it's hard for us to factor in. So the guidance we give basically reflects assumption that we believe to be reasonable today. So Daniel talked about, you know, the recovery speed of each of our businesses, and particularly for like China retail, local service, you know, and international business, et cetera. So based on what we've seen today, and you know, we see this quarter to date transaction volume and also user activities, et cetera, has already experienced a similar a growth that at a similar rate to the December quarter level. So that's a basic assumption that we used. And you mentioned about 1P, 3P. So you can see from our revenue breakdown for the 2020 fiscal year, 1P business as a percentage of the total revenue already went up to around 16%, 17%. And we believe that percentage is going to continue to go up, but not dramatically. But the important thing is that people are thinking about, you know, your revenue contains a bigger portion of 1P. But 1P normally represents, you know, a low margin. But look at our profit growth. I think this is another point I want to make, is that we are a group that has such a, you know, strong growth for the core, and also has a multiple engine, not only Taobao, Tmall, China retail marketplace, but also cloud, new retail, local services, logistics, right? So strong revenue growth brings in, you know, the powder for us to invest in those strategically important areas. And these investment areas, they're doing better and better, which reflects into our profit growth.
Sorry, interpreter, I gave a wrong answer. 谢谢，好的，这是Maggie，我来回答你的问题。现在我们面临的这些很多的风险，很多的不确定性，确实呢很难去准确的预测，很难去把控。比如说疫情会不会出现第二波，比如说疫苗什么时候能够研制出来，比如说地缘政治的。 因素会不会带来影响，这些都是不得而知的。因此的话呢，我们做指引的时候，我们所使用的假设是我们认为至今合理的假设。那么刚才 Daniel 在发言当中已经详细介绍了我们各个分布业务迄今恢复的情况，包括我们中国的零售商业本地生活服务，还有。 全球这个商业跨境这个零售等方面，那么从今天的趋势来看，就当前这个季度至今的这个趋势来看，那么实际上无论是交易量还是用户的活跃度，基本上已经是恢复到了12月份季度差不多类似的这样一个水平，所以可以说这是我们所做的一个基本的假设。那么另外你问到关于EP3P的。 这个比例问题，那么在2020财年当中，我们 EP 这个业务占到总体收入的一个比例已经是增至16%，那我们认为这个比例的话呢会继续的上升，但是不会呢有这个戏剧性的大幅的一个上升。当然很多人可能在想，这个当 EP 模式占到收入 越高的一个比例之后，是不是 EP 的这个利润率很低呢，或者是较低呢？那么实际上，纵观我们阿里的业务各个业务的这个利润率 还是非常的强劲，而且不光是我们核心商业的部分，淘宝天猫，还包括我们的考拉，我们的本地生活服务等等方面，所有这些方面我们都有较强劲的这个收入增长和较好的利润率，那么可以说为我们提供了弹药，可以进一步投资于这个战略性的这个新兴的这个领域，从而进一步推动我们的增长。
Next question, please.
Thank you. Next question comes from the line of Alex Yao from JP Morgan. Please go ahead.
谢谢管理层啊，我是 Alex。那个刚才的谈话中，咱们有聊到一季度的广告收入，因为有这个推荐信息流广告的支撑，所以表现的还可以。所以我想问一下，咱们关于我们这个电商信息流广告变现的进展和想法。因为我猜想咱们的答复里面肯定会提到一个我们讲了很多遍的，要平衡商户的利益和我们的这个变现的之间的一个平衡。所以我想这个跟进问一个问题是，有没有一种可能，比如说通过技术的方法，在既保证商户利益是这个有保障的，甚至是这个利益是更好的前提下，我们也能够做到更好的变现。如果可能的话，有没有可能是今年？谢谢。
Thank you. I noted in the earlier remarks, your comments about advertising revenue in the first quarter performing well, driven by good performance of recommendation feeds. And in that context, I'd like to ask about your plans for monetization of recommendations. I imagine that in your answer, you'll talk about the need to balance the interests of merchants against the desire for monetization. So given that, perhaps I could go ahead and just ask the second part of the question. Namely, is there any technical or technological method that could be adopted on the one hand so as to fully protect the merchant's interests or even better serve the merchant's interests while at the same time also providing more opportunity for monetization? And if so, that's something that could happen this year.
好，谢谢 Alex。我先说一下这个你问的这个后面部分的问题啊，我觉得这个答案是有的。这个唯一的答案就是技术的应用，就是人工智能的这个进一步的应用啊，能够使得我们这个一方面能够让用户的体验在这个在商业的推广啊、商业广告和免费的内容之间啊，能够获得一个好的一个这样的一个平衡啊，减少差异啊。另外一方面也是通过技术的力量啊，能够使得这个商家的这个投入的 ROI 能够到一个好的水平啊，我们一直是在这样的努力的啊，我们也是看到了非常好的一个进展啊。这个同时我们整个信息流的这个推荐啊，在这个我们的这个整个的这个收入当中，我们是非常这个谨慎的啊进行推进，和希望能够这个在比这个整体的这个刚才你问的这样的问题能够更好的解决的基础上，能够得到这样的一个这个商业广告和用户体验、商家价值的一个完美的统一啊，我们一直是这样做的啊，过去的一个季度啊，我们也是这样做的啊，所以这是你现在看到的结果。
Thank you. Well, I'll start with the latter part of your question, and the answer is yes, there is technology that can do precisely that, and the technology is AI, artificial intelligence. Which can be applied, and we are already working on applying it in a way that can ensure a good user experience in terms of balancing advertised content versus free content for users, and also leveraging that technology for merchants to drive better return on their investment. So we're working in this direction, and I think we're already making good progress. So in general, we are moving forward cautiously in working on growing revenues from recommendation feeds, and it is our hope that we can find ever better ways to do precisely what you mentioned in your question, namely finding the best possible balance leveraging on technology between user experience and creating value for merchants.
好，我想补充一下，Alex，我Maggie，那个刚才肖子讲的比较清楚了，但是我想补充一个关键词，我们也会之后会多次提到，就是我们的多引擎，就是当你看到我们的收入，如果往前推三年的话，CMR 和 commission 的收入占到我们总收入的比例是70%以上啊，那我们最近一期的财报你看到就是40%几，所以我们之前的战略投资其实已经培养出一批这个收入增长非常快的这些业务啊，这是第一点。然后第二点呢，这个就是在CMR commission 这里面，其实我们也是多引擎，就是之前呢搜索 P4P。如果再往前看三年，其实它的这个占整个这个CMR 的比例是90%以上，基本上我们都是直通车嘛。那现在呢，其实它已经下降了20%以上，就是说它现在你看这个占比的话，它其实只是七成多，所以意味着实际上我们还有很多其他的收入来源正在成长。那这里边当然包括recommendation fees 这一类的，当然除了它，我们看到了就是直播也好，闲鱼也好，对吧？就是我们特秀也好，品搜也好，有很多的这个新兴的这个 revenue stream。第三呢，我想讲就是说 recommendation fees， 因为我们之前的这个 investor day 上也讲过，这个我们会比较谨慎的这个来 monetize， 但其实现在看起来呢，它进展也非常好 ，conversion 啊这些都在健康的进展着。那我们几年前这一块的收入，能只占到我们整个的这个CMR 收入的个位数。现在呢，我们已经看到它是 10 大概就是10%几的这样一个占比已经上来了，也不是那么吃力，我们会把握好这个几个方面的利益啊。
Thank you. I'd just like to add a couple of points on top of Daniel's already very clear answer. And the key word I'd like to add in is multi-engine approach. So if you look at our revenue over this three-year period, revenue from CMR and commissions accounted for 70% compared against 40%. And what this means is that our strategic investments are starting to produce new channels of revenue, new sources of revenue. So you can see this in our figures over the three-year period for CMR as well, 90%, and that's down now by 20% to about 70%. So you have all of these different new revenue areas that can be tapped into, including recommendations that we've talked about, but also live streaming, also Xianyu, and many other new sources of revenue. So thirdly, and in conclusion, going forward, yes, we will continue to, as we said on Investor Day, to take a prudent approach in moving forward with monetization.
Thank you. Our next question comes from the line of Thomas Chong from Jefferies. Please go ahead.
Hi, good evening. Thanks, management, for taking my questions. My question is more about the spending power of the buyers post-virus. Can management comment about the overall spending power of consumers these days? And with that, can you comment about the trend in ASP and order frequency that we would expect as people speeding up the migration to online? Thank you.
好，谢谢管理层。我提两个问题。第一个问题就是在疫情过后这个期间，消费者的一个消费能力有什么样的变化和趋势？你们今天看到的这样一个消费的力量是如何的？第二个问题呢是关于ASP 就是比单价还有购买频次这些方面的一个趋势，你们怎么看？谢谢。
Okay, let me answer this question. First of all, I think on our platform, we are such a huge consumer platform. We have different tiers of consumers around us. So what we see is that consumers, they engage with us and find what they want in different categories, in different pricing range. But we do see some shift of the product categories in this quarter because of the pandemic. For example, we see a very strong growth of food and groceries business. And because people, when people stay at home, they have to cook at home, they are unable to go to the restaurant, so they need more food and more groceries, which are all daily necessities. So that's why we see very strong growth in our FMCG categories and food categories. Our FMCG categories grow take example like in the starting from the new fiscal year, our FMCG categories in Tmall grow nearly like 40%, around 40%, which is a very strong indicator that people spend more on our platform in these categories. Well, because of the pandemic, people spend less on like apparel, fashion, because people wear face masks and they don't even need these, makeups. So I think the spending still there, but the focus are quite different. But in terms of the general, spending power, I would say China is a famous high saving rate country. And we do see people remain in their consumption, remain in a very strong consumption power to continue their, to maintain their lifestyle. So so far we haven't seen any big, change in terms of the consumption power. But as I said before, I think the product categories we do see some difference.
好，谢谢。我来回答一下这个问题。我是 Daniel。在我们的平台上呢，我们看到呢，我们是一个巨大的面对消费者的平台，有很多不同层次的这个消费和消费者。那么不同的消费者来到我们的平台，来寻找呢他们需要的不同的品类和不同的这个价格的商品。那也看到呢，这个对于不同品类的一个消费。这个行为也发生了一些变化在疫情的期间，那么食品生鲜这个品类这个消费是大为上升的，因为大家隔离居家隔离不能外出去餐厅吃饭，那么必须呢天天在家里自己烧饭吃，所以的话呢食品生鲜包括快消品这些品类呢有强劲增长的这样一个趋势。那么实际上就快消品来说，从新的财年开始，我们天猫上看到呢，同比增长速度大概是达到40%那么这个说明呢，有很强劲的这样一个消费的趋势消费的力量还是在那里。但是与此同时，像服装、时尚这一类包括这个化妆品。那么这个消费是有所下降毕竟大家都是戴口罩，也没有必要化妆了，所以的话呢，消费的力量还是在，但是品类的这个侧重点是发生了一些变化。那么中国呢是有名的高储蓄率的这个国家，消费的力量还是在那里，这种需求还是在那里，但是品类呢可能会有所变化。
这个我补充一这个 let me clarify one point. When we talk about beauty, what we see is like skincare still remain very strong, but for makeup, because as I said, when ladies wear face masks, they may the need for makeup getting lower. So that's basically the situation.
好，我再补充澄清一点呢，就是说到。美容这一块其实对护肤品的需求还是很旺盛那么受到影响的具体的来说是化妆品，因为女性戴口罩就不需要那样子去化妆了。谢谢。
Next question. Operator, next question.
Thank you. Our next question comes from the line of Jason Elfstein from Oppenheimer. Please go ahead.
Thank you. I just want to go a little bit deeper into that last point. You said that online physical good GMV grew 10%, and then you did break down that you saw 25% in these categories that benefited or were more COVID-related, offset by areas where they didn't spend money. What do you think is a kind of more reflective of the consumer health? Is it that 10% number, or really is it that kind of 25%, and consumers have the ability right now to spend more? They're just not, because they don't need the items, consistent to what you talked about, not needing makeup if you're wearing a mask, for example. And maybe talk about how that relates to your outlook for the next quarter. Thank you.
好，谢谢。我想进一步追问同样的这个话题，因为你们报告说线上实物商品的这个交易额是增加百分之十，那么就是受到疫情的所谓有利影响的这些品类，它可能是增长百分之二十五，但是的话呢，另外的一些品类，像您刚才说的这个化妆品的话，它是大幅下降，因此。 抵消了这样一个增长。那么我想知道这两个数字当中，你认为哪个是更能说明未来方向的，是百分之十这个数字还是百分之二十五？也就是说，今天的情况是不是说人们有钱可以消费得起，但是暂时在疫情期间他不需要做这样的消费，就像你说的戴口罩就无需购买这个化妆品。 然后呢，请你把这个回答再去联系一下你们对下一季度的一个展望。
Okay, let me answer this question. As we said before, our China retail our Tmall grow like 10% in the March quarter, and in Tmall we have our FMCGs and consumer electronics. The combined growth rate in March quarter for these categories on Tmall is about like was about 25%. But if you want to get a big picture of the future development, I think in my remarks I give you a very clear indicator, which is like in starting from the new year on the quarter to date. Overall speaking, our China retail marketplace growth rate is similar to those in December quarter. So I think that's the basically the big picture of where we are today. But all people understand that the there is still uncertainties about the containing the pandemic. So we'll closely monitor the situation, but we strongly believe that the consumption power in China is still very strong, and we will take our advantage in the digital platform to continue our leading position.
Next question.
确实刚才讲到三月份季度当中，我们的天猫这个交易额是增加百分之十，那么其中这个快消品和这个消费电子品这两类加在一起啊，综合来说在这个三月份季度当中是增长百分之二十五左右，但是大家都知道。 对于未来的这个，就如果想知道未来的一个宏观的一个发展的这么一个大局，我想最好的一个说法就是还是回到我在发言中提到，在新的这个财年，就是本财务季度至今这段时间以来，我们中国的零售市场上它的增长呢，大概是和十二月份季度类似。 是大体差不多，那么应该说这个是宏观面上这么一个很好的一个指标，可以说明情况。当然，大家都知道这个疫情后续的发展也是充满不确定性。 所以我们会继续紧密关注这个情况的这个变化。但是我想的话呢，这个在中国的消费者他们的消费力量依然还是非常的强大。那么作为一个强大的数字平台，我们会发挥数字的优势，这个运营好，那么来进一步的推动消费的增长。
Yeah, let me add one more point, which is like if you look at the past fiscal year, we generate $1 trillion GMV, I mean, in Alibaba ecosystem. But if you look at our China retail marketplaces, the GMV we generated last fiscal year is about like 6.5 trillion RMB. And if we look at the if we look at what happened in the March quarter, I think we should have achieved a higher GMV. I mean, if without this pandemic, obviously. And but we are very confident that in the new year, I think we will achieve another like a net add of like at least one trillion RMB GMV. In our China retail marketplace, which is, I think, a still very strong number compared to the size of our business in China.
Another, 我可以补充说明一点，就是我们在这个刚刚结束的这个财年当中，我们阿里巴巴全生态是实现了$10,000,000,000的这个 GMV。那么其中呢，我们中国零售市场的 GMV 是达到6.5万亿人民币这样的水平。那么如果说没有受到疫情的影响，我想我们三月份这个季度当中，我们的表现还会更加的好。那么我们现在还是有信心，在新的这个财年当中，我们可以实现呢中国零售市场交易额可以再增加$10,000,000,000人民币这样一个目标。那么这个数字相比呢我们现有的这个市场的规模来说也是非常可观的。
Okay. Next question.
Thank you. Next question comes from the line of Gregory Zhao from Barclays. Please go ahead.
喂Daniel, Joe, Maggie, Rob, 谢谢接受我的提问。恭喜非常强劲的业绩。我的问题是关于咱们的云服务的这个业务，就我们看到一些国际上的一些云服务的供应商，比如说微软，比如说谷歌，他们在过去几个季度，即使他们之前的这个收入的基数已经非常大，他们仍然可以做到一些收入的这个比较高速的增长，甚至是加速增长。回头看中国的这个云市场呢，我们看到一个大概的一个趋势呢是。像巴巴和我们的一些这个竞争对手，整个的趋势是有一点点稍微的有一点是减慢的，所以想问一下，您觉得中国市场和这个国际市场上相比咱们有哪些比较有哪区别，就是说或者我们现在是有什么短期的瓶颈在什么情况下我们可以达到一个质的飞跃，我们可以看到我们的云计算的收入，包括我们的这个盈利这个利润可以达到一个高速的增长，谢谢你。
Thank you, and congratulations on the strong performance. My question relates to cloud services. We know that internationally, players like Microsoft and Google, who have already achieved significant scale in terms of their size and their revenues, continue to be able to maintain rapid growth in their revenues and even acceleration. Looking at China, however, in the cloud space, Alibaba and its competitors seem to be seeing a different trend where things are somewhat slower. So I'm wondering if you could compare for us, please, the China market versus the international for cloud. What are the differences underlying that picture, and what are the short-term bottlenecks, and how would it be possible potentially to make a big leap forward in terms of accelerating revenue and profit growth in cloud?
好，我来说一下这个问题啊。 第一个，其实今天这个过去的一年，阿里云我们这个云智能的服务也站上了一个非常重要的一个 milestone， 就是400亿的一年的收入，仍然是以58%的速度在这个 March quarter 在增长，这个还是一个非常快速的一个增长，这个我们不觉得这个增长看到瓶颈或者减慢，其实这个我相信云的时代才刚刚开始。
Thank you. Well, first I'd like to say that in the past year, Alibaba Cloud Intelligence hit a very important milestone, namely reaching revenue of 40 billion, and even in the March quarter, achieving 58% growth. So we don't see slowdown at all. Conversely, we think the growth is good.
其实这个增长的潜力可以从几个方面能看到。第一个是来自于整个 今天所有行业都要这个上云，这已经是一个所有的这个行业的共识。这个如果我们看这个中国的 IT spending， 这个 IT 的花费，这一块在未来上云以后，其实整个现在 IT spending 上云的部分的渗透率其实还是刚刚开始。
We see this growth coming from several different areas. One is the demand across all sectors of the economy to get onto the cloud. And if you look at Chinese IT spending in the future, we can expect to see more and more spending going forward as organizations get themselves on the cloud.
第二个方面我想还是在这个产业互联网上面，今天我想这个上云不仅是一个基础设施的上云，这个技术基础设施的上云，所谓 ARS 的上云，更重要的是能够帮助企业上云以后能够充分运用好大数据，运用好云计算的算力和算法，能够为这个企业的经营带来效益和增量。我想这个围绕着不同行业的这样的这个行业的这样的一个产品和解决方案，这个是以这个 真正帮企业产生价值，而不是只是节省这个IT成本，我想这是未来的一个重要的潜力。
The second thing I would point to is that the cloud is not just a way of providing infrastructure on the cloud to lower IT-related operating costs. It's also an opportunity for companies to leverage on big data and cloud-enabled computing capacity to achieve better efficiencies and drive value for the business. And different kinds of algorithms and analytics will be developed in the cloud for different sectors, for different verticals, different product solutions to meet those needs and unleash new value for them. So it's not just about saving costs on IT infrastructure, it's about driving value as well.
所以在阿里巴巴我们把这个 cloud 和 intelligence 是放在一起的，我们不说这只是一个 cloud service， 而是说一个 cloud plus intelligence service，这个是我们的这个特色。同时呢，我们也是看到其实这个云的服务的定义，其实业界有不同的定义，这个不论是中国还是海外，其实如果是只是把一些流量性的产品做一个售卖，其实是一个转售业务，这个 而不是真正一个产生增量价值的这样的一个情况，所以阿里我们有意识的控制了这样的一个整个的低质量的这些服务或者低附加值的服务的这样的一种方式，更重要的是追求这个云的产品核心产品的一个使用和增长。
In Ali, the value proposition that we offer is cloud plus intelligence. So we're not just about providing cloud services. It's a combination of cloud plus intelligence. Now, in different countries, cloud services are defined differently. It's true in China and internationally as well. There are different definitions. But to us, if it's just about shifting traffic onto the cloud to save costs, that's kind of a low value added offering, and that's not really what Alibaba is. It's focusing on higher value-added cloud-enabled offerings that can truly create value for clients in different sectors.
最后再讲一下，就是你刚才问到的，就是中国的 这个云市场和海外的区别，我想最大的区别还是这个 SaaS 的生态，开发者的生态啊。我想在美国或者海外，我想这样的生态已经非常成熟，而中国我想这样的开发者生态，包括这个 SaaS 的生态的这个丰富啊成长还刚刚开始，而阿里也非常愿意跟所有的开发者合作伙伴一起来共建这个云的未来的生态。
And finally, on your question as to the differences that we see in the Chinese cloud market versus the cloud market overseas, I would say that in the U.S. and in other more developed markets, the SaaS and the whole ecosystem developers are more mature already, whereas in China, that developer ecosystem and SaaS is just starting to get going. And Alibaba very much looks forward to partnering with developers to jointly create a very robust ecosystem in China.
Okay. Next question.
Thank you. Next question comes from the line of Alicia Yap from Citigroup. Please go ahead.
Hi. Good evening, management. Thanks for taking my questions. Congrats on the strong results. My question is on, so if you could give us some colors that on the subsidy measure that you help provide merchants, do you think that is actually more effective through the commission rebate, or merchants actually prefer more free traffic? And given recommended feeds actually becoming quite effective for merchants, so does that mean over the next few quarters, we don't have to provide more preferential commission rate over time, or is that is a separate thing, and the CMR and commission growth direction will still be a bit diverge? Thank you.
好，谢谢。我这个问题呢是关于你们近期给到商家的辅助补贴措施，想要知道怎么样对商家更有效，是给他这个佣金的回扣更有效呢，还是给他免费流量更加有效？那么下一季度啊会不会继续给到他们这种无偿的或者是优惠的这个佣金的一个安排？那么展望未来这个 CMR 和佣金的增长趋势如何？
Alicia, let me first answer your question. I think first of all, we are trying to help our merchants, especially SMEs, during this pandemic. But we have to, first of all, we have to give a very fair and transparent policy to all the merchants on our platform. So that's why we decided to use the subsidy to waive the annual fees and also give some reduced commissions in some of our business. But this is applied to all the merchants on our platform. And in terms of the free traffic, this is a very interesting question. I would say when we decided to give this support to the merchants, we have to consider the user experience on our platform, because we are a marketplace, we are a platform model. So we have to consider the interest of both merchants and consumers. So if we give free traffic to certain, merchants, I think conversion rate, their click-through rate of the product may or may not be good enough to the customers. So that's why we don't want to do this one-side effort. So we have to ensure the good user experience on our platform. But at the same time, we want to share. We want to subsidize our merchants to relieve their financial pressure. So that's how we think about these, policies.
好，谢谢你的问题。当然了，我们是想要帮助商家，尤其是中小企业。但是同时的话呢，我们要对所有各类商家要公平透明，因此的话呢，我们是做了这样的决定，就是呢豁免免收这个年费，然后呢在某些业务方面这个在佣金上给一些优惠，但是这些措施呢是适用于所有的商家。 那么关于你问的这个给免费流量这个问题，这个其实是很有趣的一个问题。当我们在做研究如何帮助商家的时候，我们其实是考虑到平台上的这个体验，用户的体验，因为我们是一个平台经济，那么我们要保证呢商家的利益和消费者的用户的这个体验，他们的利益都是可以得到平衡的照顾，都给到商家这种免费的流量，那么它的点击转化率会不会够好够理想这个是很难说的因此的话呢，我们就决定不要采取这种一面倒的这个做法，还是要平衡照顾，因此的话呢做了这样的一个决定。
Let me just supplement a little bit, Alicia. So for the subsidy and preferential commission rate, these are two separate things. Subsidy, we're talking about like waiving of a merchant's annual fee on Tmall platform. That's a support during COVID-19, right? To help them to go through this difficult time. And this preferential commission rate is an ongoing effort that we have this practice all through these years. And talk about the either subsidy or preferential rate. I think our operational philosophy is that we're not a believer of just burning money to grow the GMV. We believe that, whatever investment we make, it should be the supporting the sustainable growth rather than just burn and throw away the dollars. So if you look at our profitability, right, this year we're talking about somewhere over 140 billion RMB, and we have like 50 billion US dollar cash on our accounts. So they are money to invest, but you know, we are emphasizing on helping merchants in an efficient and effective and sustainable way. Thanks.
Operator, one last question.
这是关于这个补贴和优惠的佣金这其实是两个不同的事情补贴的话呢是今年在疫情爆发这个期间当中，我们是为了帮助商家免收了天猫上的这个年费那么关于优惠的这个佣金费率，这是一个持续的项目，已经有几年的时间了。那么无论是补贴也好还是优惠的这个费率也好那么阿里巴巴并不认同那种烧钱来这个寻求交易额的增长这种做法，我们是不会去做的我们做的任何的投资，我们希望能看到有可持续的这个增长那么你也可以看看我们今年的这个盈利情况，我们是有大约1400亿元人民币，那么加上我们还有呢500亿美元的这个现金，就是希望做的任何投资都是可持续高效的。
OK,
thank you. Well, final question comes from the line of Mark Mahoney from RBC. Please go ahead.
Thank you very much. If you were to talk about the biggest structural changes you think that will occur to your business or to the digital economy because of the COVID-19 crisis, what would you say they are? You highlighted increased shopping for groceries online, but including that, other things, just step back. What do you think are going to be the biggest structural changes, permanent changes in the way that consumers around the world interact digitally because of this crisis? Thank you very much.
好，谢谢。我想问的问题就是说在疫情爆发以后，你认为会给你们的业务或者是说给整个数字经济带来哪些最大的结构性的这个变化？比如说你刚才已经讲了这个现在消费者习惯于用手机买生鲜那么除此之外，可不可以讲在大的方面，你认为全球的消费者比较可能长期来讲有哪些结构性的或者是永久性的一些变化？
Okay, I think on top of the new category penetration, like in the food and groceries. I think more the other very important change is the education and the penetration in the customers who are not, I mean, a very, I mean, experienced internet user or online shoppers before COVID-19. For example, what we see is that during the pandemic, many elder people, they move to online and buy everyday needs. And so it's not only about the category penetration, it's also about the user penetration. So we do see this change the lifestyle of many, many people. And the second thing is not about consumption, it's about change the way of working and change the way of education. So that's why in my remarks, I said that our DingTalk experienced a very, very robust growth during the quarter because of they become a very important platform for people, for working people who stay connect and to improve the working efficiencies. And for students and schools, and DingTalk become a very efficient platform for online classroom. So I think this is all about change of the lifestyle, change of the way of working, change of way of education. So this is a very, very fundamental, these are very fundamental changes. I would say this will stay ever, I mean, even after the pandemic.
<咳><咳>好，那么除了是一些新的品类，像食品、生鲜。 的这个渗透以外的话呢，我们还看到教育方面这一个新的变化，也就是说有新的一些消费者，他们之前不太了解互联网，不太上网，也不会到网上购物，那么疫情爆发以后的话呢，他就是学会了，尤其是一些老年人在疫情爆发以后，我们看到更多的老年人到线上去购物，所以这个新的领域的渗透不光是品类方面，还是人群的。 这个方面有很多人在疫情期间改变了他的生活方式，另外一个方面就是人们的工作方式和教育学习的方式。刚才我在发言中也讲了，本季度当中我们的钉钉产品它有强劲的增长表现，正是因为它可以在疫情期间给很多人新的一种远程办公。 协作协同，包括教育学习的一些新的这个方式方法，那么这个应该说，在深层的方面改变了人们的生活，在疫情结束以后，我想这样的趋势还会继续延续。
Okay, thanks everyone for joining the call today. If you have any further questions, please feel free to contact the Alibaba IR team. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, ladies and gentlemen. That does conclude our conference for today. Thank you for participating. You may all disconnect.